The next item of business is a debate on motion 13015 in the name of Julian Mackay on Abortion Services Safe Access Zones Scotland Bill at Stage 1, and I invite members who wish to speak in the debate to press their request to speak buttons. I'll just allow a moment or two for front benches to organise themselves. And with that, I call on Julian Mackay to speak to and move the motion. Up to 9 minutes, Ms Mackay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I am delighted to open the Stage 1 debate on the General Principles of the Abortion Services Safe Access Zones Scotland Bill. I want to thank the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee for their scrutiny of the bill over the last few months. I'm also grateful to everyone who gave evidence, and I know from recent experience that appearing before committee can be daunting, so I appreciate everyone who did so, no matter their perspective. Given the significant issues this bill raises, it is right that scrutiny should be robust and challenging, and the Stage 1 report shows it has been both. That makes me even more pleased that the committee has endorsed the bill's general principles. I also want to thank all of the campaigners, including Back Off Scotland, Abortion Rights Scotland, individuals and clinicians for their work, support and campaigning. We undoubtedly wouldn't be here without them all, and many of those who have campaigned for this are with us in the gallery today. Firstly, I want to provide some general comments on the bill. This is a relatively small bill, but the size does not reflect the depth of feeling it's provoked or the scale of change it will bring. There are, I think, three reasons for that. The first is simply that abortion can be deeply polarising. I don't expect or intend to change that. Even across this Parliament, we will hold different views. But this bill is not about the rights or wrongs of abortion. It's about the right and ability of patients to access care without running a gauntlet of disapproval and judgment. That relates directly to the second reason for opposition. Some don't think there is a need for safe access zones. Presiding Officer, as I recently told committee, I wholeheartedly wish that was so. But too many have brought forward testimony that says otherwise, and I will share a couple of examples. From a woman responding to my consultation, there's this harrowing account, and I quote, "When walking into the clinic, I had two large older men screaming at me, calling me names. I had no one with me and no one to defend me when I was in no fit mental state to defend myself." She goes on to say, "Because of their cruel words during such a horrific and vulnerable time in my life, I carried that guilt for years." And from Professor Sharon Cameron, who gave evidence to committee, "Women attending clinics have clearly been distressed, while others have been phoning up in advance of a consultation, anxious about entering the building and worried about protesters and perhaps media. Feedback that we got at the time was that they were feeling targeted, anxious and harassed. Staff are also anxious and concerned about patients being put off attending services, and the situation has resulted in additional workload." And I urge anyone who doubts the bill's necessity to reflect on those testimonies. Attending any unfamiliar medical procedure can be stressful. Most of us will worry about whether it will hurt or whether something will go wrong. Is there anyone here who doesn't think that would be more stressful, more frightening even, if you also had to worry that there might be people waiting outside to convince you not to go in, to perhaps call you names, or to inaccurately suggest there might be consequences of that procedure you hadn't thought of, like cancer or infertility? All this bill does is try to prevent that for women seeking an abortion, to ensure that they have the same dignity and privacy they would at every other medical procedure. That doesn't mean members should stop asking tough questions about the bill. But I ask that members take the opportunity to protect women at a time when many are already incredibly vulnerable, and all are, at the very least, making an enormously personal decision that should not be subject to unwanted comment from strangers. That leads me to the third reason for opposition. This bill does raise issues around freedom of expression, religion and assembly. I know there are those who agree with the bill in principle, but are concerned on those grounds. I've never taken these concerns lightly, and I would never stand behind a bill that threatened these fundamental rights. But I am confident this bill is a proportionate means of protecting women and staff from activities that, as you've heard, can have profound consequences. However, the Chamber not need rely only on my judgment. The Stage 1 report says, and I quote, "The committee has concluded that the restrictions the bill imposes on those human rights are set out in Articles 8, 9 and 10 of the ECHR are proportionate to its aims, namely strengthening the ability of women seeking an abortion to exercise their own rights under Article 8. I remain very willing to discuss concerns at more length with any member, but I can assure the Chamber that the committee did not take these questions lightly either. That's evident given the recommendations within the report, some of which I will now turn to." Absolutely.
Alex Gould-Hamilton.
I'm very grateful to Gillian Mackay for giving way. Can I also thank her for her leadership on this very important and excellent bill? Ms Mackay was very kind enough to meet with me about a concern I have about a provision of the bill, which I wholeheartedly support, about the ability for future governments to reduce the size of the buffer zones we're talking about without recourse to Parliament. On reflecting on the Stage 1 report, I see that the committee had similar concerns. Would she address those in her remarks?
Julie Mackay.
I thank Mr Cole-Hamilton for that intervention. I will come to some of those things that we discuss shortly. As I hope the Chamber will understand, much of the report's detail is still being worked through. However, I will provide what assurance I can today. Firstly, I note the repeated call for a post-legislative review. As a sitting member of this Parliament, it is always my expectation that legislation is reviewed, which is why I followed general precedent and did not explicitly provide for it. However, recognising the particular concerns and the difficult balancing required around this bill, I am content to provide a review amendment for Stage 2. Similarly, I note the concerns about reduction and extension powers, and specifically the recommendation that consultation should be required on the face of the bill. I judged that consultation would occur as standard practice and that it was unnecessary to specify it. However, again, recognising the issues in play, I will bring forward an amendment to put that matter beyond doubt. There are other recommendations around extension and reduction, as well as parliamentary scrutiny more generally. Those are complex and important issues, and I'm keen to give them the due consideration they deserve. I won't commit on concrete actions today while that consideration is underway, but I do commit to continue to listening to concerns from around the Chamber and alleviating as much of them as I can, and that's true for the report as a whole. Absolutely.
Bob Dorris.
Thank you, Member for coming. Can I apologise to the Member that I was trying to speak to you ahead of making this intervention? The Stage 1 report was fascinating, and you've got my goodwill in relation to this legislation. One of the provisions in the bill is that other related services connected to abortion but not abortion clinics could become within the scope of a buffer zone, if you like. And I think the policy memorandum talks about pharmacies possibly being one of those. There's pharmacies in every high street, and a concern of mine might be the extension would lead to, say, a pro-life group being unable to have a stall in a high street. So that's a concern I have. Is there some reassurances you could give, or perhaps we could reflect ahead of Stage 2?
Julian Mackay.
No, absolutely. I can give Mr Dorris the reassurance that the current number of sites that are protected are the ones that are designated under the 1967 Abortion Act. So any other services at the moment with the bill would have to be designated under that act as providing those services. So that's what would stop what has essentially been called mission creep at the moment. But I'm happy to have a wider discussion with Mr Dorris about that after Stage 1. There's one final point, Presiding Officer, that I must address, and that's the recommendation that the default distance of the zone around protected premises should be reduced from 200 metres to 150 metres. I'll happily discuss my position with all interested members over the coming weeks and at committee at Stage 2. However, I must and will resist such a change. The Stage 1 report refers to scoping work showing that 150 metres suffices for all but one premise. We identified that premises and factors needed to be addressed that could provide a captive audience, such as bus stops, places to come in and out of services and sites. We needed to make sure that the zone was big enough to capture all of those places. And I realise I may have to come to an end, Presiding Officer, but I'll hopefully be able to cover that at the end. But I am happy to speak to any members ahead of Stage 2, and I commend the bill to Parliament and move that it agrees to the general principles of the Abortion Services Safe Access Zone Scotland Bill.
Thank you. And I now call on Claire Haughey to speak on behalf of the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee. Up to 8 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I refer members to my register of interest in that I hold a bank nurse contract with Greater Glasgow and Clyde NHS. As the convener of the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee, I'm pleased to speak today to our Stage 1 report on the Abortion Services Safe Access Zone Scotland Bill, and can I thank the committee clerks and Spice colleagues for their work on this report. This bill is ultimately about achieving a balance between conflicting human rights, between the rights of those accessing abortion services to have privacy and to feel safe and secure when accessing those services, and those who would wish to exercise their right to express their opposition to abortion outside the premises where those services are provided. With this in mind, the committee has taken a careful and considered approach to scrutiny at Stage 1, and in doing so, our focus has been to determine whether the restrictions this bill imposes on the human rights of certain individuals is proportionate to its aim, which is to protect the human rights of those of other individuals and to strengthen their ability to exercise those rights. Article 8 of the European Convention on Human Rights requires the state to ensure that an individual is protected against interference in their private life, and this includes an individual's right to access abortion services or provide abortion services. It also includes the rights of people who may live in a proposed safe access zone. Under Article 9, everyone has the right of freedom of thought, conscience and religion. And under Article 10, everyone has the right to freedom of expression. Under Article 11, everyone has the right to freedom of peaceful assembly. None of these human rights are absolute. They can all be restricted to protect the rights of other people, and we set to scrutinise not only the provisions of the bill, but also if it's proportionate to restrict the rights of one group of people in favour of another. This bill is not concerned with the legality of abortion. In this country, abortion is legal up to 24 weeks of pregnancy and beyond if there is a significant risk to the life of the person accessing abortion services or evidence of fetal abnormality. However, it would be remiss in this context not to recognise that not everyone agrees with abortion, and that's the main reason why people gather outside abortion services to express their beliefs. Presiding Officer, during our scrutiny, we heard evidence that activity by those opposed to abortion had increased outside clinics in Scotland in recent years. We heard about activity occurring outside a number of premises in Scotland. And we have taken extensive evidence from both those who have been affected by activities outside abortion services and from those engaging in those activities. And I'd like to thank everyone who assisted the committee with its scrutiny, those who responded to our call for views, and those who gave evidence in person or online. And I would particularly like to thank Back Off Scotland and the Society for the Protection of Unborn Children. Both organisations helped us to engage with individuals, both formally and informally, to hear their personal experiences. Some people chose to speak to us in private, and others spoke publicly on the record. And weighing up the evidence that we heard, the committee has concluded that the restrictions the bill places on human rights are proportionate to its aims, and as a committee we support the general principles of the bill. But we are clear that we must tread very carefully here. As a parliament, our guiding principle must be to ensure that any restrictions on human rights should be kept to the minimum necessary to meet the bill's policy aims. Our report highlights areas where the committee thinks that the bill could be clarified or strengthened in this regard. And one of our key recommendations is that the legislation should be subject to ongoing review to ensure the restrictions continue to be proportionate to the legitimate aims of the bill if circumstances change. We believe that provision should be made for regular post-legislative review to ensure the bill's implementation remains suitably proportionate, balanced and effective over time. The bill sets out that the safe access zones should have a standard radius of 200 metres and also makes provision for the radius of individual sites to be extended to address site-specific circumstances. We've also heard that a radius of 150 metres would be sufficient to address sites covered by the bill, with the exception of the Queen Elizabeth University Hospital in Glasgow. To align with the principle that human rights restrictions should be kept to a necessary minimum, we propose in our report that the default radius of the safe access zones in Scotland should be set at 150 metres. Once the bill is in force, separate provision should be made to extend the radius of the safe access zone at the Queen Elizabeth University Hospital to address the specific situation at that site. We are also of the view that processes in the bill to extend or reduce safe access zones should be subject to stronger safeguards. We believe there may be justification for setting out minimum and maximum limits for these on the face of the bill. And we also believe that decisions on reducing or increasing the size of safe access zones should be subject to a human rights proportionality assessment, prior consultation with service providers and other relevant stakeholders, and parliamentary scrutiny via delegated powers. The committee agrees with the definition of protected premises as set out in the bill. However, we remain concerned that any future decision to widen this definition could result in the bill applying to a much larger area than currently intended, and as a result, having a far greater impact on human rights. Again, this is an area where care will need to be taken to ensure the bill's impact remains proportionate to its aims, and where Parliament will have an ongoing role to play in carefully scrutinising future decision-making. The committee spent a considerable amount of time exploring potential scenarios arising from the bill's implementation, what would or would not constitute an offence, and how potential offences could be managed. Key areas of focus included silent prayer, displaying religious iconography, and what takes place in private premises, people's homes and religious institutions located in a safe access zone. On the issue of silent prayer, as the report makes clear, there are different views within the committee. Some members felt that the bill should include a specific exemption for silent prayer. Other members believe that doing so would fundamentally undermine the bill's purposes. We have concluded that silent prayer is a matter that will need to be debated further should the bill progress to stage two. And I'll take Mr Mason's intervention.
John Mason.
I thank the committee convener very much for giving way. Does she think it's the police would be able to put that into practice as to what is silent prayer or what is somebody just reflecting themselves?
Claire Hawkey.
Well, Mr Mason reflects some of the discussion that the committee had and some of the evidence that the committee had regarding silent prayer, both with people who had held vigils or protests outside of abortion service providers and also with the police. So that's why the committee's recommendation is that this needs to be debated further at stage two. Notwithstanding this difference in view on the issue of silent prayer, the committee has concluded that for the bill to be implemented appropriately, individual cases will need to be carefully assessed based on their particular circumstances. For that to happen, we recognise the critical importance of giving police officers on the ground the necessary specialist training to ensure appropriate enforcement of the offences created by this bill. Our report calls on the Scottish Government to commit to providing the necessary funding to deliver that training and for this to be reflected in an updated financial memorandum. In conclusion, I look forward to hearing contributions to this afternoon's debate and to considering this bill further should Parliament vote to approve its general principles.
Thank you, Ms Hawking. Just to advise the Chamber, we are very tight for time this afternoon, so members will have to accommodate any interventions in their speaking time allocations. And I call Jenny Minto, Minister, up to 7 minutes, please.
Presiding Officer, it is my privilege to support this bill. I would like to thank the committee for their consideration. This bill raises important issues and I appreciate their thorough and thoughtful scrutiny of the evidence they heard. I'd also like to recognise the work of the Scottish Government Bill team and also my colleague Marie Todd for the preparatory work she led. In responding, I will do my best not to repeat the points Ms Mackay has made. Ms Mackay has, with her usual insight, set out why this bill matters. I therefore join with her in urging those of you who doubt the necessity of the bill to listen to the women and staff who have had the courage to speak. We are here because of them. We must not forget them. Ms Mackay has also confirmed the amendments she will introduce at stage two. The government fully supports these positions. Likewise, we share her reasons for fiercely resisting the reduction of zone distance from 200 metres, and I too am very happy to discuss this with any member who has concerns. I am aware that there are some areas of the Stage 1 report, for example around finances, which require a Scottish Government response. Once we have considered more fully, we will gladly provide that. Of course.
It's Cole Hamilton.
I'm very grateful indeed for the Minister giving way. On the same topic I raised with Gillian Mackay on the potential reduction of the distances of the buffer zones, does she recognise that these are provisions that are not in law in England or in Northern Ireland, where these measures have been brought in already and they're functioning without them, and perhaps we can too?
Minister.
I recognise what Mr Cole Hamilton has said, and I'm very happy to have further discussions with him with regards to this. However, today, because it is a source of particular concern for some, I will focus on silent prayer. I have appreciated the considered discussions with members on this topic. I know that this is a difficult and complex subject. I'm also aware that prayer, for many, is an act of profound significance. The bill does not either, by intent or effect, undermine this government's respect for that, or the right of anyone, whatever their faith, to hold whatever belief they choose. The bill criminalises behaviour, and I am paraphrasing here, that is intended to, or is reckless as to whether it does, influence a decision to access or provide services, impede access to services, or cause alarm, harassment or distress to someone accessing or providing services. The bill does not criminalise silent prayer. The offences have been defined in this way to avoid unintentionally creating loopholes. However, two points have been made around this that relate to silent prayer. Firstly, that activities such as displaying placards or carrying out silent prayer are not harmful. I recognise that this belief is sincerely held. However, I must point out that the sincerity of that belief does not change the impact. As you've already heard from Ms Mackay, what that impact is. Indeed, the Supreme Court also acknowledged this impact in its ruling on the Northern Ireland legislation. It is therefore right and necessary that these activities can be caught if circumstances require. The second point is that by allowing prayer to be potentially caught at all, we are criminalising thought.
Thank you for taking intervention. How will we be able to police this?
Minister.
If Mr Gohani will allow me, I'm just coming on to that in my speech. Presiding officer, I can wholeheartedly say that this is not so, because again, only the impact matters. If someone prays silently on their way to the hospital, or indeed takes a few minutes to stand quietly outside, it is very unlikely anyone would know they are praying. Let me be clear, it is not the prayer that gives rise to the offence. It is the facts and circumstances surrounding the whole conduct. As the Supreme Court recognised, silent but reproachful observance of persons accessing an abortion clinic may be as effective as a means of deterring them from getting an abortion as more boisterous demonstrations. Again, it is not the prayer itself, but the sense of judgment that can be harmful. And I repeat, prayer in itself is not an offence. Crucially, determining whether behaviour is an offence will always be for Police Scotland and the Crown and Procurator Fiscal Service. Those organisations already make such assessments. For example, the threatening or abusive behaviour and stalking offences under the Criminal Justice and Licensing Scotland Act 2010 and the domestic abuse offence under the Domestic Abuse Scotland Act 2018 all require judgment on the effects of behaviour. Finally, as drafted, the bill only creates safe access zones of 200 metres around 30 premises. Everywhere else, those who oppose abortion on whatever grounds can make that opposition known in whatever lawful manner they choose. That does not mean the offences and this particular issue should not be scrutinised. And I am genuinely grateful for the robust challenge we have received. But I am confident the bill as drafted is the best way to provide the protection women and staff need. And I'm equally confident in the experience of our enforcement agencies to implement it proportionately. Presiding officer, Ms Mackay highlighted the subject matter as one reason this bill is contentious, noting that some of us in this chamber will continue to hold radically different views on abortion. Truly, we can always rely on radically different views across the chamber on a whole range of subjects. But this bill is testament to the potential for even this divided chamber to find common cause. I'm extremely proud of the arrangement that has brought this bill to fruition. It speaks to the strength of this Parliament, that a member can drive such a process, and it speaks to the power of collaboration, that government and a member can work as one, even on such a complex issue. More than that, it shows how we can unite across all party lines when we are motivated by a greater good. in this case to protect and defend the dignity and privacy of women accessing vital health care and those providing it. This unity of purpose has been clear since Ms Mackay held her first debate on the issue in 2021. Contributions from Carol Mochan, Alec Cole-Hamilton, Megan Gallagher and others highlighted the need for action, and the meetings I have held with opposition members too. Today, we have the opportunity to take that action. In my first speech in this place, I quoted Edwin Morgan's poem, Open the Doors. These words, in my view, talk to this bill. We give you our deepest, dearest wish to govern well. Don't say we have no mandate to be so bold.
Thank you, Minister. I now call Megan Gallagher up to 6 minutes. Ms Gallagher.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I do welcome the opportunity to open today's debate on behalf of the Scottish Conservatives. For the past few weeks, my inbox has been full of constituents writing to me, and of course it will be the same for other MSP colleagues, about their views on Gillian Mackay's abortion clinic buffer zone bill. Opposing views, of course, but it is important that everyone has the right to put their argument to their MSPs who are elected to this chamber. These debates are never easy. They are emotive, they can be polarising and can easily divulge into debates about social conscious issues. But for me, I don't see this debate about abortion today, and I am pleased that that has been reflected across the chamber so far. People do have strong views on whether or not they support abortion, and everyone, of course, is entitled to their view. But this bill, in my opinion, is simply about women and creating safe access to healthcare where they don't feel intimidated or harassed. And I think that is a reasonable ask. Therefore, I do commend the work of Gillian Mackay to bring forward a bill that aims to protect and support women. We will, of course, not be the first Parliament to look at such legislation. The UK Parliament voted in favour of establishing buffer zones in England and Wales that creates a perimeter where certain activities could not take place. So the Scottish Conservatives will support the general principles of the bill. However, I do want to outline some concerns that were identified through the committee stages that still needs work should this bill move on to stage two. The harrowing accounts shared by women at the Health and Social Care Committee is a stark reminder that women fight every day for their rights to be upheld. Therefore, it is incumbent for MSPs to bring forward meaningful legislation that sets out clear aims and objectives. Because regardless of whether the principles are right, if the bill is unworkable, it won't provide the right protections that it aims to do. I think Gillian Mackay has covered quite a number of the concerns raised in her opening contribution. And one of the first concerns I was going to raise was surrounding the meter parameters surrounding the buildings in question. But I do understand that she has addressed that element, so I'll certainly move on to the other concerns I was going to raise, because policing, I think, will be more problematic when looking at this bill. There is a long-standing argument in this country, and it's one I wholeheartedly support, that surrounds the rights of freedom of expression and religion. And we've already mentioned silent prayers, and where it is appropriate to perform silent prayers, whether it can be done at home or anywhere. I think the question that I still have, and I think it will take a lot more exploration to actually come to the conclusion, do silent prayers need to happen outside of a clinic? Can people gather in another location that would allow them to express themselves whilst giving women the ability to access healthcare? But still, I do fundamentally agree that religious freedom is, of course, a protected characteristic, and I'm just not entirely sure how we work around this in terms of the bill that's been set forward. There then is, of course, the enforcement argument. More consideration, I think, is needed surrounding how intimidation is defined to ensure that the bill is clear in its objectives. But I think the largest stumbling block within the bill relates to how this law will actually be enforced. How it will be enforced equally? Will it be down to individual determination by officers? When will people know that they might actually be breaking the law? What happens if someone, again, that's been already raised, is expressing themselves within a home that is included within a marked zone? I think it will be incredibly difficult for police officers to determine breaches of the proposed bill, but I think this is something that we can tease out certainly at stage two and at stage three should the bill progress on to those stages. And I'm going to bring back the argument of silent prayers. Should this be an exemption or is it seen as intimidating? I think it is different from examples that we have heard that is clear intimidation where leaflets have been handed out, if words have been exchanged. That, in my view, I would view that as intimidation, and it would be traumatic for clinicians, women and everyone who's accessing the clinic for whatever purpose, because I think we do need to remember that not everyone who's accessing these clinics is, of course, accessing the clinic for abortion services. I certainly will, yes.
Eleanor Whittam.
Gallagher for taking that intervention. I wonder if she agrees with me that women have been silently judged for hundreds of years going about their daily life, and I think that this bill actually will seek to actually address that in terms of how women feel when they're running the gauntlet of individuals whose intention it is through silent prayer to intimidate and harass, and that's going to be the crux of the argument that she's bringing.
Megan Gallagher.
I think it's good points raised by Eleanor Whittam. I think for me, it is about making sure women have that safe access to these clinics. That is the fundamental principle of the bill, and that's certainly why I back the bill, because I do believe that that should be the case. But I think we are treading, and it's already been highlighted by others so far, the human rights element, which is so, so important. And I think we've got to be very careful how we move forward to make sure that we've got a balance and it doesn't tip. Because if we tip the balance, I think that can create more animosity, it can create more of a problem than what this bill is actually trying to solve. And I think the bill is, in the right place, but I think it's how we move forward to make sure that all of the issues that have been highlighted this far are teased out. Presiding Officer, I know I'm against the clock, so I am going to conclude on that point. So can I just thank Gillian Mackay again for bringing this bill forward. I certainly look forward to looking at the bill at Stage 2 and Stage 3, and I will certainly be voting for the bill at decision time. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Gallagher. I now call Carol Mochan up to 6 minutes. Ms Mochan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. In opening this debate for Scottish Labour this afternoon, can I begin by thanking the Health, Social Care and Sports Committee for producing this Stage 1 report, the clerks, of course, for assisting the committee in its work, and indeed all those who gave evidence on this matter. Can I also thank Gillian Mackay for bringing forward this legislation and for working cross-party to achieve its aims as set out. On a personal level, I have been supportive for the introduction of safe access zones to protect women accessing abortion services. It has long been my view of my party, that Scotland ought to have been leaders in this area, but the government have been slow to act, meaning Scotland is catching up with other parts of the UK. In my view, this could have been avoided, the various summits and conversations led by the former First Minister, as we predicted at the time, did not lead to any sort of prompt action. However, having said this, I do wish to make it absolutely clear that Scottish Labour supports the Member's proposed legislation. It is right that we take all steps necessary to protect women accessing abortion services, and I do believe the introduction of safe access zones will achieve this. Presiding Officer, the truth is, as we have heard, access to abortion clinics is access to health care, and we cannot continue to condone the intimidation facing women accessing health care that they are so rightfully entitled to. Members here, we can all understand visiting a health care setting can be worrying and stressful for a whole variety of reasons. And women accessing sexual health services, specifically abortion services, could be going through an extremely challenging, emotionally traumatic and physically draining time in their lives. We heard this in evidence, as well as hearing feelings of stress were initiated by the presence of intimidating behaviours. Women need to have safe access to the services and advice they require, and I do believe the bill will work to achieve that. Now, moving to the Stage 1 report and the Member's response to committee, Scottish Labour support the view of the committee on proportionality and legitimate aims. Scottish Labour is of the view that any restrictions on human rights brought by any bill must be kept to an absolute minimum, and we are content that the bill achieves that aim. In the time I have left, I want to focus on three key areas. There's so many areas that we could issue and debate on, but of course we do have restrictions in time. I want to focus on three key areas that I believe are important to get right as we go through the next stages of the legislation. I do agree that robust post-legislative scrutiny to obtain an understanding of how this bill is working and progressing is absolutely required. And as such, I do agree with the committee's recommendation in this area. And I'm pleased that the member too has accepted this and will work in this area. She will seek to bring forward amendments, and I believe once drafted, because she will work cross-party, will deliver the reassurance that the committee sought in this area of the report. Moreover, on the same point, Scottish Labour is of a view that it is absolutely right that when it comes to implementation, a common sense approach is required and will require individual cases to be considered in relation to their own set of circumstances. And I'm quoting from the report when it states that operational management of enforcement of the legislation will have a critical role to play in ensuring its appropriate implementation. I consider this to be a key point, and I would be interested to hear from the Minister in terms of the Government's view on ensuring the implementation is as successful as possible. Secondly, Presiding Officer, I think on the area of trade union activity, it is important that the Bill protects the rights of trade union activity in relation to the advancement of workers' rights. The right of workers and our health service to protest and call for better pay terms and conditions, for example, must not be undermined indirectly by any legislation. The recommendation of committee to expand this exemption to ensure trade union concerns that activity may be considered as an offence is an important one, and I do hope the member will continue to engage with the trade unions, specifically our health trade unions, to see what work may be needed to carry out to allay any further fears in this matter. Finally, Presiding Officer, the issue of silent prayer was one that came up on various occasions during the taking of evidence, and indeed, as noted in the committee report, led to a difference in views being held by the committee. On a personal level, I am reassured by the member's provision of clarity in her letter to the committee, and I know that she will work with others to make sure that we get this right. The member has been very helpful when discussing. In concluding, Presiding Officer, I once again reiterate Scottish Labour's support for this bill at stage one and commit my party to working with Gillian Mackay to improve the legislation in many of the areas that members have spoken about so far and I'm sure will go on to speak about to make sure this legislation enters the next stages in a cross-party way as possible. The bill is clearly required to protect women's access to these services. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Ms Mochan. I now call Ross Greer up to 6 minutes. Mr Greer.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'd like to, on behalf of the Green Group, congratulate our colleague and friend Gillian Mackay for bringing this bill to Parliament and to congratulate all the campaigners and the health professionals who fought for so long for this moment. I would also like to thank colleagues on the Health Committee for allowing me to participate in Stage 1 proceedings, even if I did miss the Finance Committee's field trip to a quarry to do so. One other person that I want to thank on behalf of the Scottish Greens, and it's our former Northern Irish Green colleague Claire Bailey, who passed the UK's first safe access zone legislation. So much of what's now being achieved in Scotland, England and Wales is because of Claire's work in Northern Ireland. Every Scottish Green MSP will, of course, vote for our colleague Gillian Mackay's bill today. Access to healthcare is a fundamental right. Women's right to access reproductive healthcare, though, in Scotland, at this point in time, is being compromised by anti-abortion protests. Anyone is free to hold to an anti-abortion point of view. Freedom of thought is absolute. But our right to manifest our views is not absolute, and in this case does not trump a woman's right to access healthcare. This bill poses a question of how we balance rights. This is ultimately a small restriction on the right to protest and religious expression to allow others to fully exercise their right, the right to healthcare. And I sincerely believe it is a small restriction because it is not a ban on protest. It is purely a ban on proximity when doing so. Restrictions based on proximity already exist. You cannot protest abortion in the waiting room of the hospital or inside the building at all. That argument is not one that we're having. This is about the extent to which we set those limits on proximity, because clearly what is currently in existence is not sufficient. That doesn't mean we should create such restrictions lightly. Any restriction on rights should be carefully considered and only go as far as necessary to achieve balance. But the reason I believe this restriction is small is that I just don't believe proximity is essential for those wanting to express anti-abortion views. And I posed that question to witnesses who engaged in or supported what they describe as anti-abortion or pro-life vigils. Prayer can absolutely be a form of protest. I say that as someone whose faith is deeply important to me. But for the purpose of this argument, I will accept their premise that it is prayer, not protest, that they are engaging in. And that's because I want to talk about the Christian theological dimension to this. Not all of these vigils are Christians, but the vast majority are. Those who gave evidence to us were. And it's important to understand the motivation of those engaging in behaviour that we are seeking to prevent and displace. Bishop Keenan from the Catholic Church explained the importance of prayer to Christians, and I agree. But his evidence and that of others strayed between prayer and preaching, and that engages different rites and different questions of faith. Christians are called to spread what we consider to be the good news, but we're explicitly not called to pray performatively in public. Jesus is actually really specific about that. Just before introducing the Lord's Prayer, he said, "And when you pray, do not be like the hypocrites, for they love to pray standing in the synagogues and on the street corners to be seen by others. Truly, I tell you, they have received their reward in full. But when you pray, go into your room, close the door, and pray to your Father who is unseen. Then your Father, who sees what is done in secret, will reward you." That's in Matthew chapter 6, for anybody who wants to do a bit of further reading. The presiding officer was presented with a lovely new parliamentary Bible last week that I'm sure she would lend to other members. When Jesus said that those who are praying for others to see them have already received their reward in full, he was making the point that it's a prayer directed towards those around them, not towards God. The reward is the attention of other people, and he condemns that. The point about who prayer is directed towards is a critical legal question here. Praying to God, either by yourself or as a group, does not require proximity to what or to who you are praying for. I'm not saying proximity is never important and has no value, but proximity in this case is clearly intended to influence the outcome, i.e. to persuade or to intimidate women into not having an abortion. And at that point, you are clearly impacting someone else's ability to exercise their rights. Your rights, therefore, need balanced against theirs. Quite obviously, you cannot access abortion services somewhere other than at an abortion service provider. But you can pray and protest and preach elsewhere, including just up the road. Restrictions on rights, even to achieve balance with other rights, are significant enough to usually warrant ongoing scrutiny. And the Health Committee recommended amending the bill to include those provisions for post-legislative scrutiny, and I welcome Gillian Mackay's commitment that she'll bring forward such amendments at stage two. Despite the Abortion Act having come into force across the UK almost 60 years ago, it's still a deeply politicised area of healthcare. The organisations who put together anti-abortion protests in Scotland have been repeatedly found to spread dangerously false claims, including that abortion increases your chance of breast cancer. Utterly, utterly false. They say that both sides of this debate must be heard. Well, clearly there are two well-understood sides of the moral argument, but the provision of health advice is for healthcare professionals. It is not a space for political debate. That can and does take place elsewhere. Presiding officer, this is an opportunity for Parliament to listen to women who have sought abortion and been profoundly affected by these protests, and to the other patients, service users, families, relatives, chaplains, hospital staff and others who have been affected as well. As Gillian Mackay and others have said, we are not debating abortion today. I recognise that there are some who deeply disagree, but public opinion and that of Parliament is settled on this. The Abortion Act has been in place for almost 60 years. Support for women's bodily autonomy has only increased since then. But a small number of those opposed to this are actively attempting to compromise women's ability to exercise a hard-fought-for right. These are creeping attempts to bring the tactics of American culture wars to Scotland. Today we have the opportunity to reject those attempts to protect women seeking abortion and to pass the principle that Scotland should set up safe access zones around our abortion clinics.
Thank you, Mr. Greer. I now call Alex Cole-Hamilton again. Up to 6 minutes, Mr. Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you very much indeed, Presiding Officer. And can I, as I did in my intervention to Ms Mackay, once again congratulate her on her leadership on this subject. Can I also thank action groups like Back Off Scotland, other stakeholders and indeed the committee for their scrutiny. Presiding Officer, when I was first elected to this place in 2016, within 18 months I'd asked the first questions about safe access zones and raised a number of questions and written several articles. But it took the election of Ms Mackay to this chamber in 2021 to actually move it to a statutory footing where we are today. I am so glad that we are here, and she should be profoundly proud of herself. Presiding Officer, this is an emotive issue. It is often divisive, but it demands of us that we not shy away from the reality faced by those seeking access to safe and legal abortion services in this country. It boils down to this, Presiding Officer. Nobody should be forced to cross a picket line to access intimate medical care. Scottish Liberal Democrats have been guardians, among others, of freedom of expression within the bounds of the law. But we are quite clear, we are entirely clear, that this bill is compatible with that tradition. So we are pleased to support it today. Presiding Officer, the Pregnancy Advisory Service has said that 70% of women in Scotland live in a health board area where protests have taken place. In 2019, they say that more than 100,000 women were targeted outside clinics across the UK. I'm not suggesting all of these protests outside clinics or the protesters themselves are guilty of harassment. I'm no doubt many do so peacefully. However, women attempting to discreetly access this health service have reported being bombarded by questions, subjected to placards showing graphic and disturbing images and lists of misleading information, much of which we have just seen about the impact on their health. Some protesters have even used tripod-mounted cameras to threaten and to intimidate. One woman told Back Off Scotland that she was accused of murdering her baby when she spoke to protesters outside that clinic. One of the defining features of Liberal Democrats is our passionate defence of those civil liberties. Freedom of speech, the right to protest, must always be protected. But that doesn't mean that anything goes. It never has. Where you express yourself has always mattered, and we have always restricted that expression where it might breach the peace in some way. All this bill seeks to do is to ensure that anyone accessing medical care can do so without harassment or fear or judgment. It seeks to safeguard their basic right to medical privacy. I know there are those who oppose this bill for fear it will trample over rights of religious assembly, that silent prayer should be permitted, exempted from this. But I've spoken to several religious figures, and I have some faith myself, and they have no such fears. They are okay with buffer zones. One chaplain told me last week, God doesn't care where you pray. He will hear you wherever you are. So why must this prayer occur on site? With all the attendant judgment inferred by the subject of that prayer, I think Ross Greer answered that well in the scripture he just quoted. Some may argue that introducing these buffer zones threatens that right to protest. That is something I reject on several counts. These are not protests in the usual sense. Those picketing outside clinics are not seeking to change policy or law or influence decision makers. They're pressurising individual women and attempting to change their mind on the most personal of matters of individual choice. And choice is at the very heart of this. The right to choose is the fundamental precept of our attitude to reproductive rights and our policy around reproductive rights in this country. In the vast majority of cases, if you've chosen that, you've not done so lightly, and you certainly don't need a nudge in the opposite direction at the very final step. Anti-abortion protesters have the right to voice their opinion. Of course they do. But that does not trump another's right to medical privacy, and it does not include the right to harass or intimidate. And it goes without saying, Presiding Officer, that any discussion of a woman's decision whether to have an abortion should be conducted in a safe and confidential environment with the help of trained professionals who are qualified to offer the appropriate advice and support. I note a recent survey poll that showed that 82% of Scots agree that protesters should be kept a minimum distance away from attending healthcare facilities. I am very pleased to see there is a broad consensus across all parties in support of this measure. I still have concerns, as I have expressed in both interventions, about the powers of the bill as drafted to offer ministers the ability to reduce the size of buffer zones if they so choose, and I welcome the committee's observation around that in their report. Neither England or Wales or Northern Ireland handed such powers to ministers in the legislative instruments they have brought in to bring about buffer zones. So why should we? It's not necessary and risks undermining the bill. I have met Gillian Mackay, I'm grateful for that, and Jenny Minto in recent months to discuss this, and I look forward to working with them to find a way through to make sure this section of a bill is proportionate and appropriate, because we have to pass legislation for governments years ahead of us, as they may become, not as we would wish them to be. And we must make sure that if any amendment to the rights that we protect in this bill are subject to the will of this Parliament by affirmative procedure, if there is legislation that's required. To conclude, Presiding Officer, introducing buffer zones around these clinics is a reasonable and proportionate step to protect safe and discreet access to abortion services in this country. I am very proud to offer the support of the Liberal Democrats, Gillian Mackay's bill. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Cole-Hamilton. We now move to the open debate. I call first Rona Mackay to be followed by Sandus Kulhani. Up to 6 minutes, Ms. Mackay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. This is a very important debate, and I'd like to thank Gillian Mackay for all her work, her office and bill team and the Health Committee for getting us to this crucial stage. Presiding Officer, peaceful protest is a key principle of our democracy. I know that everyone across the chamber agrees with that. But protests targeted at women trying to access healthcare when they are at their most vulnerable are simply unacceptable and downright sinister. Praying for the souls of unborn children is a human right, and no one is arguing against that. But if these protests or peaceful prayer are located outside the entrance to a hospital, then that moves the dial massively. I believe that these so-called vigils amount to the targeted harassment and intimidation of women. Now, I understand that the protesters don't see it as that, but that is most certainly the effect on women entering clinics. Singing, chanting and praying outside hospitals and abortion clinics throughout Scotland, often carrying lurid pictures, are designed to create distress. This is not freedom of expression. This is passive aggression at its worst, designed to heap blame and to emotionally blackmail women into feeling guilty and ashamed. On some occasions, the protesters distribute false medical information to suit their argument, and some target passers-by and patients by shouting and accusing them for accessing abortion services. This is cruel, unkind and unnecessary, not only to the women accessing healthcare, but to the healthcare workers themselves. Rape Crisis Scotland has stated that anti-abortion protests outside clinics have a clinical, emotional and psychological impact. The activities of anti-abortion protesters cause distress and have the potential to cause trauma to survivors accessing abortion services. The tactics they've deployed involve targeting people attending the clinics, passing out distressing information and pictures, and displaying messages on banners. These actions may cause them to defer their treatment or purchase illegal abortion pills online from unregulated providers. This impact will be particularly acute for survivors of rape.
Can I take an intervention?
Yes, certainly.
Gillian Mackay.
I thank Rona Mackay for taking the intervention, but the member also reflects on the fact that because of the nature of how healthcare is delivered in Scotland, there's actually a whole load more services that are affected by these protests in Scotland than there are in England, Wales and Northern Ireland because of the hospital campus nature of the sites that we have. For example, some of the protests can be heard within the neonatal intensive care unit at the Queen Elizabeth Hospital, so the impacts are much, much wider on healthcare as a whole.
Rona Mackay.
Thank you. Yes, I completely agree with that. I think the unintended consequences of these protests are just, you know, off the scale. The impact, yes, so the view reflected that of many individuals and organisations who were concerned for the welfare of vulnerable individuals accessing healthcare services. The Royal College of Midwives responded to the bill's consultation saying, abortion services are an essential part of women's healthcare. Healthcare professionals, including our members, deserve to undertake their work without being harassed and abused. One woman told Back Off Scotland, who have run an excellent campaign in support of buffer zones, said, I went into hospital first thing in the morning and was faced with a group of protesters holding up placards. They remained there 7 hours later when I left the clinic. My privacy and safety were threatened and it was a deeply intimidating experience. Presiding Officer, I ask the question, do any of those people have any understanding how difficult the decision to terminate a pregnancy is or the circumstances which brought them there in the first place? Of course they don't. If protesters are seeking to change the law, why not do it outside the Scottish Parliament where laws are made, or why not pray outside the Scottish Parliament? This bill does not limit the ability to oppose abortion in other places. In accordance with the requirements of the European Court of Human Rights, the provisions of the bill strike a balance between the right to respect for private and family life and the rights of assembly and association, freedom of expression, freedom of thought, conscience and religion. Presiding officer, 70% of Scottish women of reproductive age live in a health board with hospitals or clinics targeted by anti-choice groups in the past 5 years, and it's on the increase. That's completely shocking, and that's why buffer zones around the entrance to a clinic or hospital are so absolutely necessary. Buffer zones are already in place in Canada, Australia and parts of England and the USA, so they're not a new concept. I know that some people, including members and some committee members, who are speaking today's debate, have concerns over people being criminalised for praying if they're caught in the buffer zone. I'm personally not religious, but friends who are tell me that praying is a private activity, usually carried out at home or, of course, with fellow worshippers in a church. And Ross Greer could explain that far better than I could. So in my view, to deliberately choose a location to press views on women at their most vulnerable is surely far from a Christian act. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, I am pleased that members will back the general principles of this crucial bill at decision time today. And as always, concerns and details can be fixed at stages 2 and 3, and the member has shown great willingness to accommodate everyone's concerns in that regard. Access to healthcare is a human right, so let's protect those rights for women at a time in their lives when they need support more than anything else. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Mackay. I now call Sandis Gulhani to be followed by John Mason. Up to 6 minutes, Dr Gulhani.
Thank you. And I wish to draw members' attention to my register of interest as a practising NHS GP. Presiding Officer, it's important to stress that we are not considering whether abortion services should be legal or not, nor are we proposing to change Scotland's abortion law. What we are talking about is women's access to healthcare. As a male doctor, I will obviously never undergo an abortion. Abortion services primarily cater to women's reproductive health needs, and I cannot underestimate the importance of respecting women's autonomy and prioritising women's access to safe and confidential care. This means we should ensure women can receive the medical care that they require without facing barriers such as harassment outside clinics. So, in terms of general principles, to protect women from intimidation and potential emotional distress caused by protesters outside these facilities, I support the principles of the buffer zones. By safeguarding access to abortion services, we are upholding women's reproductive rights and ensuring women can make informed decisions about their healthcare without undue interference or pressure. And it's well documented why Parliament is considering this legislation simply from hearing people's comments today. Protests can intimidate women who seek a whole range of services as clinics, many of which provide sexual health support, HIV testing and contraception. And protests impact our NHS staff working in these centres, forced to pass what amounts to an accusatory picket line at the start and end of each day at work. We've heard arguments that safe access zones would impinge on right of freedom of speech or freedom to protest, and for sure, people may have personally held views, but it doesn't mean that they have a right in every case to deprive others of their rights. That said, I would defend the right of patient groups to demonstrate peacefully outside a hospital, for example, for the closure of services, or if there were patient safety issues, like in the case of NHS Tayside's Professor Eljamel. I would also not seek to restrict the right of trade unions to protest. And I am seeking reassurance on the face of the bill, given that during evidence and health committee, the police told us that this might happen as an unintended consequence. Protecting the privacy and well-being of women accessing abortion services is at the heart of the proposed legislation. But is the bill ready? I don't think it quite is. The proposed 200-metre safe access zones outside 30 hospitals and clinics across Scotland should deal with the real problem of harassment and intimidation. But we need to ensure the bill is workable and avoids unintended consequences. Take prayer vigils. Are we asking the police to determine whether the law is breached by a bystander who may be engaged in silent prayer? Are we criminalising thought? We must be clear how we police this, given during evidence at committee, the police were clear that they would not ask somebody why they were there at a buffer zone and were clear that they were not the thought police. We also need to consider residential or business premises or places of worship that may be within the 200 metres of a clinic. No one is penalised for displaying a flag or poster of their favourite football team or political party in their window, even if some find this antagonistic. So where is the line? I am primarily concerned with defending women's right to safe healthcare and protecting NHS staff. That's why I support the principles of this bill. But as we take the bill forward, let's work together on the details so we deliver good law. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Gulhani. I now call John Mason to be followed by Monica Lennon. Up to 6 minutes, Mr. Mason.
Thank you very much. And I do thank you for the opportunity to speak today. And I have to say, I actually mean that for once. I realise that my views and those of the people I speak for are probably a minority and possibly a very small minority in Parliament today. But I believe it is important that minority views are heard at Holyrood. This gives increased credibility to Parliament and to all of our parties. Can I also say too at this point that the SNP has long been a party which is a big tent or broad church. We are united by our commitment to Scotland, but we include a range of views on many issues, including the economy and on social policy, with some being more liberal and some being more conservative. And I want that range to continue. It does not mean that one side needs to defeat the other, but rather that we hold a healthy tension and respect each other's angle on things. Now, some have said that this bill is nothing to do with abortion itself, and it's purely about buffer zones or safe access zones. I disagree. This bill and this debate is very much about abortion. Again, others have said I only oppose abortion on religious grounds. Again, I disagree. Fundamental to all of this is the question of when life begins. Does life begin at conception, at birth, or at some point in between? I think that is more of a scientific or a medical question rather than a religious one. And I do hope it is possible to discuss this subject today, as has happened for... Let me finish this point. I do hope it is possible to discuss this subject and bill in a calm and reasoned way today, even though I accept that just discussing the subject of abortion can become very emotive and there are strong feelings on both sides. Yes.
Eleanor Whittam.
I wonder if John Mason will agree with me that the debate round about abortion is already a settled position, that we have access to safe and legal abortion for all women who may choose to have that healthcare. And this debate is actually round about access to that without fear of intimidation and harassment by women who seek to avail themselves of those services.
John Mason.
I will deal with some of the specific bits probably later on, but no, I do hold to my point that underlying this is the question of abortion. And on the whole, there may be a few that are opposed to abortion support the bill, but that would not be my position. If life begins at birth or even at 24 weeks, then abortion and this bill are purely concerned with women's rights and women's health care, as many have said already today. And I, as a male, should probably sit down and keep out of it. However, if life begins at conception, then from that point on, we are dealing with two lives, the mother's and the baby's. And if that is the case, the health care of both the mother and the baby are important. And in fact, in other instances, we do recognise the importance of health care for babies before they are born. For example, in the Family Nurse Partnership Programme, we talk about, quote, the first 1,001 days of life from early pregnancy until the child reaches the age of 2 years old, unquote. So that rather suggests that to an extent, we do recognise the importance of a baby's health before birth. And that is why not only I feel I can speak today, but I feel I should speak and have a duty to speak, whether I find the experience attractive or not. Yes, I'm an older man, I cannot carry a baby or have an abortion, but I'm elected for a range of reasons. And one of these reasons is to speak up for those who have no voice, or their voices not being heard. That can mean constituents who are very poor or lack education. It can mean children needing more support. It can mean asylum seekers with little or no English. And I also believe it means unborn babies who certainly cannot speak for themselves. Their lives are important too. Now again, some have said they are pro-life but will still support the safe access zones, as women should not be harassed or intimidated. Well, I fully agree that women should not be harassed or intimidated. But I would also say there is very little evidence of harassment or intimidation near abortion facilities. With the number of abortions in Scotland rising to over 16,000 in... No, I'm afraid not. I'm going to carry on. With the number of abortions in Scotland rising to over 16,000 in 2022, it does not appear that people are being put off by vigils or protests. And these numbers come against the background of this country having an ageing population, and we as a society are desperately in need of more children and larger families. I've twice visited a vigil, or protest if you prefer to call it that, across a wide road outside the Queen Elizabeth University Hospital in Glasgow. These groups are mainly older and mainly religious people, quietly reading or praying. They offer support and information to women who are considering an abortion. And in some cases, we know that women have not been fully informed of the options available to them, have not completely made up their minds, or may be being pressurised by a partner or family member not to have the baby. Just in recent weeks, I gather that some women have approached the vigil group, have sought more information, and have decided to have their baby. That seems to me like good news. As I think members can see, I'm opposed to abortion on the whole, and that leads me into opposition to this bill, even though I accept that the bill is aiming at only one aspect. So I have to say that tweaking or improving the bill slightly is unlikely to make it acceptable to myself or others. However, I would specifically touch on the issue of silent prayer, which I've already mentioned and others have discussed at some length. Another point not dealt with in the bill, but I think very relevant, is the age at which abortions are allowed. That has been set at 24 weeks for quite some time, but medicine and science have moved on, and babies are now surviving at 23 weeks. Our current timescale is out of line with most European countries, which have lower limits. Therefore, either in this bill or elsewhere, we surely need to review that limit. So all in all, members will gather that I'm not supportive of this bill. At the very least, I would ask members to think about the baby in all of this. Yes, the mother's health care is supremely important, but the baby is important too. And someone needs to speak up for these babies, be that in Parliament or out on the streets. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Mason. I now call Monica Lennon to be followed by Annie Wells. Up to 6 minutes, Ms Lennon.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And isn't it good that we live in a democracy and a free country where John Mason can come to this Parliament and have his say? But I do disagree with Mr Mason and others who, like him, have joined in these protests, because it's one thing to hold these views and to absolutely have the right to oppose abortion healthcare. But as we've heard in the evidence at the committee and as we're hearing in the speeches today, this is having a real impact on women in Scotland right now, and hopefully we'll hear more from their voices. So I join others in saying thank you to Gillian Mackay and her team for the hard work that has led to today. Progressing a Member's Bill to Stage 1 is really difficult, even with the support of the Scottish Government. So it's a huge undertaking, and thank you for getting us to this point. And of course, none of this would be possible without the award-winning and groundbreaking Back Off Scotland campaign launched in 2020 before this current parliamentary session. So this action is long overdue. And I think we would all agree that the best ideas often come from grassroots campaigners and those with direct experience of injustice and inequality. The Abortion Services Safe Access Zone Scotland Bill exists because of the courageous and tenacious young women behind Back Off Scotland. It's an honour to know them, in particular Lucy Grieve and Alice Murray, who I now am proud to call my friends. And it's young women like Alice Murray and Lily Roberts, just two of the women who have shared their stories bravely with the public and with Parliament, stories of running that gauntlet and facing the loud chants or the silent judgment. It doesn't matter how quiet or noisy it is, it has the same impact on women. In the time that Back Off Scotland have been campaigning, those young women have got a bit older. Lucy has just recently been married. And in that time, the protests have become more common. There's been a real escalation. And as Rona Mackay said, it has become more sinister. We've seen it at the Sandyford Clinic, where people tried to board up access to that clinic. We've seen people gather in huge numbers, sometimes more than 100 people, at the Queen Elizabeth Hospital in Glasgow, and I've seen it in my own parliamentary region in central Scotland, where people have gathered at University Hospital Wishaw, something that hadn't happened really before until my knowledge. Like others, I'm grateful to the committee for all their hard work and to those who gave evidence. Those of us involved in the cross-party group in women's health, we also heard directly from people with lived experience. And as Megan Gallagher has said, and we share the same region, we've had many, many emails from people with all shades of opinion, which is really important for us to hear. But that testimony of women and their families and the workers is really, really important. We've heard from Dr. Sandesh Kulhani, who again can bring his professional experience. But as my colleague Carol Mockin mentioned, it's also a trade union issue. And I really welcome the support from the STUC. That is a settled position of the trade union movement in Scotland. And they back Gillian Mackay and her bill. Because the harassment is not just targeting those who may be accessing healthcare services, it's those who deliver those services. And many of those healthcare workers may have had an abortion themselves or had trauma in relation to pregnancy or pregnancy loss. And that is the point here. We just don't know what people have gone through when they're going through those clinic doors. As Engender have pointed out in their briefing, anti-choice harassment outside abortion clinics in Scotland and the UK has escalated in recent years. And that harassment and that activity is undertaken with the aim of obstructing, harassing, intimidating and stigmatising those accessing or involved in the provision of healthcare. So at the heart of this, there are really important issues of bodily autonomy and of access to sexual and reproductive rights. And I am very clear that gendered harassment and intimidation is a form of violence against women and girls, and it has to end. Excuse me, I'm struggling with a sore throat today. So I've made the points about workers, about trade unions and about everyone being able to come to Parliament and have their say. I also want to mention in the final seconds Dr. Greg Irwin, who's been a real ally to the campaigners. He's a paediatric radiologist working in the Royal Hospital for Children in Glasgow, and he's talked often about the visible nature of the protests and the noise and people within the hospital environment, even though it's a big hospital, can hear it. He's talked about the bullying of women in NHS hospitals today, and that can't go on. And I will agree with colleagues that no bill at stage one is ever complete or the finished article. So I welcome the ongoing scrutiny of this bill. I'm happy to play my part, but I would really urge all colleagues to back the bill at stage one tonight. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Lennon. I now call Annie Wells to be followed by Ruth Maguire. Up to 6 minutes, Ms Wells.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I too want to thank Gillian Mackay and her team for all the work that has been done on this bill. It is extremely difficult to get a bill to stage one, so well done for that. And also, Presiding Officer, the productive cross-party dialogue from the contributions that has been made regarding the Abortion Services Safe Access Zone Scotland Bill being debated here today. The core content of this legislation is to create safe access zones that would act as a buffer between women accessing safe and legal services at abortion clinics and anti-abortion demonstrators. The zone would exist to help ensure women can access these vital services provided at the abortion clinics without fear or harassment that is often experienced from their interactions with anti-abortion protesters. For context as well, Presiding Officer, the UK Parliament has already adopted similar legislation to create buffer zones around abortion clinics in England and Wales during the passage of the Public Order Act 2023. And I understand that this legislation, as is often the case with any issues regarding aspects of abortion, has created division and competing claims of infringement of human rights. Women must have the right to access healthcare uninhibited by fear or feelings of judgment or harassment that they often experience. In many cases, such feelings caused by protests outside abortion clinics prevent women from accessing these crucial services altogether at a time when they are already making an often very difficult decision. I have also heard the concerns of this bill's critics, who claim that anti-abortion protesters would have their right of freedom of religion and speech restricted if they are deemed to be acting in a certain manner within these zones, that would have them penalised for expressing their views. However, such arguments have often been based on, for example, Articles 9, 10 and 11 of the ECHR. And this argument notably was rejected by the UK Supreme Court, which in its unanimous ruling stated that similar legislation in Northern Ireland was compatible with the Convention of Rights, the rights of protesters. This, presiding officer, is in addition to questions around the specific size of these zones, which fall between, as we've heard, 150 to 200 metres, depending on individual circumstances. And in response, the committee has urged that ministers within the Scottish Government adopt a human rights proportionality assessment when making the decision to increase or decrease the radius of the safe zones. Consequently, the committee further recommended that the bill be amended to outline the process that would see each such zones either extended or reduced, and that any such decisions should be made in consultation with service providers and relevant stakeholders. Concerning my position, I, along with my Scottish Conservative colleagues, believe that women accessing abortion services should never feel that they are subject to harassment or intimidation that anti-abortion protesters outside these clinics often pose. These feelings caused by such anti-abortion protesters can have, and often does have, the effect of discouraging women from exercising their right to accessing healthcare, with abortion services being no exception. And moreover, while I believe in the right to freedom to protest, as they will still be able to protest outside these zones, however, Presiding Officer, this bill does not set out to prevent anti-abortion demonstrators from exercising their rights under Articles 9, 10 or 11 outside of these specifically designated safe access zones. But their right to protest can also not come at the expense of women's rights to access healthcare services as she sees fit. To conclude, Presiding Officer, I will be supporting the general principles of this bill along with my fellow Scottish Conservatives this evening, and will work constructively on future amendments brought forward to this legislation. Ultimately, I believe that this bill is proportionate and strikes the right balance between guaranteeing women's access to legal and vital healthcare services provided by abortion clinics and the rights of anti-abortion protesters to express their views. And I, Presiding Officer, I welcome further dialogue with Gillian Mackay and others from across the chamber to see how we can make this bill better in the future. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Ms Wells. We now come to the final speaker in the open debate, after which we'll move to the closing speeches. Ruth Maguire, up to 6 minutes, please, Ms Maguire.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. When trying to bring about change for the purposes of campaigning and politics, I recognise a compelling and often successful route to go down can be to divide into sides. Are you for us or against us, a hero or a villain? Are you just, unjust, righteous or wicked? But as well as positively galvanising people behind what you believe to be the right side of something, that approach can, on occasion, stifle open, honest conversations and exchanges of views. It can leave folk with no space to change their minds and, at worst, on occasion, hamper scrutiny. As legislation progresses in our nation's parliament, we know that curiosity about how things will work, exploration of unintended consequences, open, honest dialogue and scrutiny are crucial to do our jobs to the best of our ability. Whilst we are here to scrutinise safe access zones alone, I feel it's important, as did the convener Claire Hawkey and Gillian Mackay, to acknowledge that the issue of abortion is challenging to talk about. It elicits really strong emotional feelings in many of us. From my perspective, the decision to terminate a pregnancy is a deeply personal one for women and only the business of her and whomever she decides to involve. And from the outset, I wish to state that I absolutely agree with campaigners Gillian Mackay and the Scottish Government that women should be able to access healthcare free from harassment, fear or intimidation. I will vote for this bill at stage one, but I do believe that further exploration of some of the issues raised within the stage one report are required. This debate gives us the opportunity to do that, as does our Parliament's amending stages two and three. The committee heard from a range of people with differing experience and views and perspectives on the bill, both in public and private session. I'm grateful to them all. I want to acknowledge particularly the women with lived experience of the matters this legislation deals with. Coming into Parliament to share personal testimony with members you've not met before is not a straightforward thing. I admire the strength and generosity of those both for and opposed to the bill who did just that. I also thank clerks and the participation team for the care and attention that they took in organising and supporting these important private sessions. In our report, committee recommended that the member in charge of the bill and the Scottish Government consider whether there may be justification for setting minimum and maximum requirements for extension and reduction of safe access zones. This was to ensure a proportionate approach in terms of the bill's impact on human rights and the potential risk of powers being misused by Scottish ministers, but to eliminate that. Now, the phrase misuse of powers by Scottish ministers might send hairs racing and make a good headline. I would maybe frame it a little differently and ask colleagues if, on principle, as parliamentarians, how much power they wish to cede from Parliament to the executive. The committee also recommended that Scottish ministers undertake a human rights proportionality assessment before making decisions about reducing or increasing the sizes of safe access zones, and that such a requirement should be included on the face of the bill, with some members being of the view that where zones moved further out of hospital grounds and into shared community space, it did require a further test of proportionality. I think that perhaps touches on the points that my colleague Bob Doris made. On the matter of silent prayer, there was a difference of views on the committee. I remain a bit unsettled about it, and I know that's not the fashionable thing to do as a politician. I know I should pick a position and fight ferociously. Right now, I kind of feel that an exemption for silent prayer may be necessary. I want to avoid the criminalisation of private thoughts, and I'm concerned about the worry of those with faith who told us they feel they may be targeted for what they think and believe and not for their actions. But that said, I also absolutely accept concerns from supporters of the bill that exempting specific behaviours may undermine the bill as drafted. And as I've said at the outset, I support the aim of women being protected from harassment, fear and intimidation as they access their right to safe healthcare. I'm very open to further discussions on these matters. I would hope we could maybe get to a place where both these things were reconciled, and if that's not possible, even when I vote for the bill at stage three, I would want to be very clear that I'd personally exhausted all avenues of resolution and could explain with clarity my decision to vote for something that, whilst upholding the very important rights of women to access healthcare, did impinge on the views and thoughts that, whilst are not the same as my own, are perfectly legitimate to hold. Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Ms Maguire. We now move to closing speeches, and I call first Lorna Slater. Up to 6 minutes, Ms Slater.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I welcome the Abortion Services Safe Access Zones Bill coming to the Chamber for this Stage 1 debate, and extend my congratulations to Gillian Mackay for championing this bill. I welcome the tone of the debate today, as well as the level of engagement and support from across the Chamber. This bill is about the right and ability of women and anyone requiring such services to access the health care they need, free from fear that they will be met with judgment and shaming. It is about ensuring that they are not being subjected to intimidation by individuals or groups wielding placards and signs, or by those attempting to impose their beliefs onto others. This behaviour not only jeopardises the well-being of those seeking access to health care, but the Royal College of General Practitioners Scotland also raises concerns that protests outside premises could result in patients delaying their access to services or, in some case, not accessing services at all. In my region, Lothian, recurring protests outside the Chalmers Clinic and the Royal Infirmary in Edinburgh have become a familiar sight. The testimony provided to committees and organisations such as Back Off Scotland and BPAS reveals a distressing reality that is marked by intimidation, anxiety and fear among those seeking essential healthcare services. These behaviours are unfortunately all too common and cannot be overlooked. In the debate today, we have heard some concerns from Carol Mochen, Alex Cole-Hamilton and Dr. Gilhani on the point around trade unions. I note this, and I also note that the STUC Women's Committee has been engaged with this bill and does support the bill. The argument has been made that hateful conduct by individuals and groups can already be prosecuted under existing laws. Extensive consultation has shown that abortion service users and providers continue to report experiencing harassment and distress outside healthcare facilities as a result of activity that is not addressed under current law. The introduction of safe access zones is not a new concept, and in fact, is a rather crucial step in ensuring the protection of individuals seeking healthcare services. While Scotland is taking strides forward in this regard, it is essential to acknowledge that we are not alone in this endeavour. England and Wales, along with Northern Ireland, have already taken significant steps by introducing similar legislation to establish safe access zones. The Abortion Safe Access Zones Northern Ireland Bill was passed by the Northern Ireland Assembly on the 24th of March 2022. The criminal offence it contains is worded in a similar way to the bill before the Scottish Parliament today. Before receiving royal assent, the bill was referred to the Supreme Court of the United Kingdom by the Attorney General for Northern Ireland. The final judgment concluded that the offence was proportionate and therefore compatible with the European Convention on Human Rights. The decision also specifically recognised that staff delivering abortion services had a right to be able to attend work without harassment, intimidation or abuse under Article 8. This underscores the recognition of the need to safeguard access to healthcare and to protect individuals from intimidation and harassment across these aisles. The Bill's provisions are fair and targeted. The Bill is not about denying people's right to protest. Everyone is entitled to express their views, including through anti-choice protests. However, the Bill focuses on creating designated areas around clinics and facilities where such protests are restricted. This is to ensure that individuals seeking healthcare, particularly women making decisions about their own health, can do so without feeling threatened or intimidated. These zones aim to safeguard individuals' safety, security, health and privacy. And as someone who has access to Chalmers Healthcare Centre because I live locally myself, I can attest that when people choose that location for protests outside a healthcare setting, for whatever reason people might be accessing it, it can only be for the purpose of pressuring and intimidating people, adding to the trauma and distress that might be on top of what is already probably a stressful day for them. The purpose of this bill is to foster a compassionate and respectful environment for all. Individuals are entitled to hold opposing beliefs regarding abortion, but they must also recognise the importance of choosing appropriate venues for expression. This bill ensures that protests should occur in more suitable locations, such as outside the Scottish Parliament, where the decisions on these laws are actually made, rather than at healthcare facilities where patients have a right to expect to access healthcare without judgment or intimidation. I welcome the Stage 1 report by the Health and Social Care and Sport Committee. Throughout its scrutiny, the committee has carefully considered the views of a broad cross-section of stakeholders, both for and against the bill. In the process of reaching a view on the general principles, it has explored a range of scenarios that may arise if the legislation were to be enacted. It has concluded the bill's provisions are proportionate and recommends that the general principles of the bill be agreed to, and I urge my parliamentary colleagues to do the same. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Slater. I now call on Carol Mochan to close on behalf of Scottish Labour. Up to 6 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I was fortunate enough to open the debate as well, so I won't take up everyone's time or too much time in closing. But in closing on behalf of Scottish Labour, I feel it is really important to thank members right across the Chamber for today's debate. I know the public today will hear this Parliament wants to get this legislation right. Time and time again in the Chamber today, we heard how important upholding everyone's human rights is, and that is the case. But it is not absolute, and the rights of women to receive health care is really important to us here in the Scottish Parliament. The question, of course, is, does the bill balance this correctly? Now, Monica Lennon and Rona Mackay reminded us of the reality for women accessing care, and at times this can be in a way that they find harassing. So it is clear that this Parliament does have a responsibility to take action to make sure that women can access that health care. Scottish Labour, like other members, acknowledge that people have differing views on this issue. And this is why it is so important, as other members have said, that we have the opportunity to take evidence, scrutinise it, and to debate this in the Chamber. And can I say that we appreciate the way in which all witnesses, both in the public and private sessions, gave us their views in a courteous way, no matter their position on the bill. And I think Ruth Maguire mentioned that in her contribution. It is not easy, particularly if you're coming to speak against the principles of the bill. But all of that was done in an extremely courteous way. As the convener, Claire Hawkey, said, weighing up human rights should not be taken lightly, and believes that scrutiny is so important. The Stage 1 report, I hope, does reflect that we did scrutinise this legislation at the stage that we are. And the debate today shows how seriously in this place we are taking this particular bill. As the Minister said, we are coming together to find common cause on a very complex issue, and I appreciate members' discussions today. As many members stated, this has to be done in a proportionate way to ensure freedom of expression and rights, but rights also to access health care. Monica Lennon, I think, very helpfully reminded us that these bills are not easy to complete at stage one, and in actual fact, that's why we have the other stages, so that we can all work together, as the member in charge of the bill has said in her contribution, and I'm sure will reiterate, that if we work together, then we can look at the issues that were raised by members. Bob Doris mentioning the protected premises and how we ensure that we get that right if it were to change in future-proofing, as some people have indicated. In Alex Cole-Hamilton's discussions and in his interventions, the restriction or the extension or reduction of the zones, again, how much power do we place in the hands of the executive, or how much should come back to the Parliament? These are all things that we can discuss at the next stage. Of course, Megan Gallagher and others spoke about enforcement. How do we make sure that that is done absolutely appropriately, and that our police force do have the support that they need for that? Myself, the trade unions are very important to make sure that people have the right to take legitimate trade union activity within hospital grounds. And then, of course, we have had the discussion around silent prayer, which was raised at the committee and was rightly scrutinised, because it is about how do we make sure that this bill is correct. So again, in closing, Scottish Labour support the general principles. We will be voting as such tonight. We welcome the goodwill from across the chamber, and in particular from Gillian Mackay. We thank the committee, the clerks and the witnesses again, and we do really look forward to robust cross-party working through the next stages of the bill.
Thank you, Ms Mochen. I now call on Tess White to close on behalf of the Scottish Conservatives. Up to 6 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Presiding Officer, the Abortion Buffer Zone Bill achieved cross-party consensus in the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee. And I thank the committee's convener and clerks, as well as the Scottish Parliament Information Centre, for their sensitive and careful handling of this bill as members heard evidence on its provisions. I also thank the stakeholders and witnesses who contributed to the committee's scrutiny of the bill at stage one. Presiding Officer, women must not be harassed or intimidated for exercising their legal right to freely access abortion services, nor for accessing other reproductive health services delivered on the same premises. The same goes for NHS staff, who must not be targeted simply for doing their jobs and providing women with the care they need. The UK Parliament, as we've heard today, has already voted in favour of the Public Order Act 2023, which establishes buffer zones of 150 metres in England and Wales. As my colleagues Megan Gallagher, Dr Sandish Gulhani and Annie Wells have confirmed, the Scottish Conservatives will support the general principles of Gillian Mackay's Abortion Buffer Zone Bill today. And in doing so, however, we recognise that this is a difficult and complex topic. We recognise, too, that parliamentarians are increasingly making decisions about the balance of rights, and in this case, the right to access healthcare and the right to protest. Presiding Officer, as we've heard today, these are not easy decisions. And against the background of the Hate Crime Act, some are understandably concerned about the precedent this legislation could set in relation to protest. Perhaps that should give the SNP pause to reflect on its policy agenda to date. However, the Law Society of Scotland does not believe that this bill is a slippery slope to curtailing the right to protest in different circumstances. The legislation is narrowly drawn, and the committee was reassured that a similar prohibition would require separate primary legislation and parliamentary scrutiny. As a staunch advocate of free speech, I recognise the rights of women facing an often challenging, personal and extremely private decision. They have a right to access reproductive health care unimpeded by protests, however peaceful those protests may be. They also have a right to privacy, and these rights should not be overlooked or ignored. And it's a very sad fact, as highlighted by Megan Gallagher today, that women fight every single day for their rights to be upheld. We welcome the...
Sorry, I believe that Ms Lennon is seeking an intervention. Monica Lennon.
Apologies, the technology doesn't appear to be working. I'm enjoying Tess White's speech, and she's also an active member of the Women's Health Cross Party Group. Does she agree that, although it's taken quite a long time to get to this point, we have the benefit of being able to look at the legal situation in Northern Ireland? We had the Supreme Court ruling, and there's obviously legislation in other parts of the UK. Is that helpful to colleagues in this place when we're trying to get this to the next stage, that we're not the first to do this?
Tess White.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Thank you, Monica Lennon, for that intervention. And we do know, of course, that the SNP government has formed for legislating out with the Scottish Parliament's competence, and just look at the GRR bill. But, as Monica Lennon highlights, the Supreme Court judgment in Northern Ireland demonstrate that this has already been tested. And as we've heard today, Scotland is the last part of the UK to implement buffer zones. So it's right that these measures progress with close scrutiny. And I hear groans from across the chamber, but that is the fact. So we welcome the committee's recommendation that post-legislative scrutiny will be key to the continued operation of this legislation once it completes its parliamentary passage. It is important that a review should be built into the bill and to ensure robust and proportionate law, two further areas of the bill will require consideration going forward. The first is the size of the buffer zone. At 200 metres, it's 50 metres bigger than the English equivalent, and I welcome the Minister's commitment to reflect on whether that is proportionate. The second, as Sandesh Gilhani and Ruth Maguire highlighted, is the impact of the bill on silent prayer, which committee members discussed at length. And key points include the human rights implications of policing silent prayer and the feasibility of enforcement. The Stage 1 report reflects the differences of opinion that emerged on this issue, and it's one we will certainly need to return to at Stage 2. In closing, Presiding Officer, it nevertheless remains that women should not feel they are being stigmatised or discouraged from accessing abortion services. Fear of judgment or intimidation should not act as a barrier to reproductive health care. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms White. I now call on Jenny Minto to close on behalf of the Scottish Government. Up to 7 minutes, please, Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As I set out in my opening remarks, I'm privileged to support the bill. As I explained when I gave evidence to the committee, it was during a trip to Oregon in the United States when I first encountered anti-abortion activity outside clinics in the early 2000s. Since then, this type of activity has only spread, and it is my sincere hope that this bill will send a clear message that women's most personal choices are not up for public debate. Once again, I'd like to thank the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee under the convenorship of Claire Haughey for their thorough consideration of the bill. And I also thank everyone for their contributions here today. I think the tone of this debate, as was highlighted by both Carol Mochen and Lorna Slater, is a tribute to this Parliament. I acknowledge John Mason's view, and as Monica Lennon said, this Parliament, this country, does give us this privilege to be able to listen to opposing views. I was particularly struck by consistent points that everyone has a fundamental right to health care. The provision of health advice is for the health service. And as Annie Wells noted, this can be at a difficult time. Rona Mackay and Tess White both talked about the emotional and psychological impact on staff, and that too has been central to the evidence that has been gathered when this bill has been debated. I think it's also important to recognise that the bill focuses on the needs of our healthcare infrastructure, so is understandably different from other parts of the country, given that we don't have standalone clinics. Ours are buildings that provide many different types of healthcare. And Sandesh Gilhani is absolutely right. Everyone, and I represent a rural constituency, I can understand the importance and reflect on the importance of safe and confidential care. I appreciate Ruth Maguire's comments. I don't think polarised views help in an open and honest discussion, and I note her powers on the shift of power, perhaps, between Parliament and ministers, and I also note her points on silent prayer and would be very happy to meet with her. I would also like to reflect, as Monica Lennon and many others have, on the courage of those who came to provide evidence. There was a lot of thought-provoking evidence given to the committee, and I note too Monica Lennon's point about loud chants or silent judgment, and that's something that I have been considering. I'd also like to thank Monica Lennon with regard to the work that she's done in the cross-party group on women's health, and also contributions to meetings that I've held cross-party, which I very much appreciate. I've listened carefully to all the points that have been made this afternoon, and although time may not allow me to respond to every member, I will address as many as I can. Firstly, I must turn to the call that safe access zones should be 150 metres in size rather than 200 metres set out in the bill, and I'm not entirely sure Tess White understood what I had said. I reiterate that considerable work has been undertaken between the consultation and the bill being introduced to ensure this was the right size. So we are working on that, and we'll provide that information as we go on. I fear that by reducing zone size, we would fail to protect women and staff when they need it most. However, as I've just said, I reiterate my offer to meet with members who may wish to discuss this further. I think one of the key things that we have looked at when we've been drafting this bill is the absolute point of balancing human rights. And again, we have undertaken considerable work to ensure that the bill strikes the right balance in terms of the protection of the fundamental rights. And we believe this bill does strike that right balance, the rights of patients and staff and those of individuals who participate in anti-abortion activity outside healthcare facilities providing abortion services.
Alex Hill-Hamilton.
I'm very grateful to the Minister for giving way. She mentioned a number of the concerns that Tess White gave voice to. On the issue of silent prayer and the policing of silent prayer, does the Minister recognise that the people who engage in protests outside or vigils outside abortion services are in fact by and large law-abiding citizens, but that if we as a parliament send a legal signal to those people that silent prayer outside of these facilities is no longer legal, that that will in and of itself police itself?
Minister.
I think what we've been very clear on is that silent prayer is not on the face of the bill. It is the intent that it results in. And Megan Gallagher also picked up on this point. And I think it's important to think about Police Scotland and how they enforce. They use the four E's, which is engage, explain, encourage and enforce. And individual facts around the reason for that event will be considered in each case. And they may each present different decisions or difficult decisions, but it's not unusual for Police Scotland to make that kind of judgment. I think the other area that there's been a bit of discussion on is around trade union activity. And the exemption in the bill is in recognition that protest activity related to workers' rights may unintentionally influence decisions to access abortion services or impede access to them, but that their purpose is distinct from pro- and anti-abortion activity. And I would also underline the fact that the Law Society also noted in their brief that the bill is specifically drafted to avoid capturing union activity or any other protest activity not related to abortion. Presiding Officer, I'm pleased that the Health and Social Care and Sport Committee have concluded that restrictions the bill imposes are proportionate to its aims. Women should be able to access abortion services without unwanted influence, harassment or public judgment, and this bill can make that a reality. I urge every member to join me in bringing that reality a step closer.
Thank you, Minister. I now call on Gillian Mackay to wind up the debate. Up to 8 minutes, please, Ms Mackay.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and I'm really pleased to close today's debate. As I've noted before, there is still debate to be had around this bill. However, I was hoping for some common ground today, and that hope, I'm very pleased to say, was not misplaced. I'm very grateful to all of those who have offered support today. These debates, I believe, show Parliament at its absolute best. Members across the Chamber have highlighted the wider impacts of the activity we're seeing outside of healthcare settings. Rona Mackay reflected the long-term impact on individuals. Alex Cole-Hamilton, Annie Wells and Megan Gallagher referenced the potential impact of protests on women's decisions and potentially deferring them from seeking care. I want to thank Ross Greer for his theological lesson, and I fully agree with the points he made around false information that has been handed out, and this was highlighted by the committee. That said, I also expected to be met with some very robust challenge, and I mean it when I say I'm not disappointed to have been proved right. Challenge is a vital part of the legislative process. It's how we make sure bills do what we want them to do and avoid doing things that we never intended. So I'm grateful to everyone who has participated this afternoon. We've been able to discuss important and emotive issues with respect and civility, and I can promise that I will take forward work on this bill in that same spirit. Given that I ran out of time in my opening, I hope that members will forgive me if I run out of time to address everything, and I'm more than happy to meet before stage two to discuss matters in detail. I've heard the calls across the chamber to exempt silent prayer from the face of the bill, and I must support what the Minister said in her opening statement, and these facts are important for two reasons. First, because prayer in itself is not an offence. That means it's not possible to exempt it as one without potentially undermining how Sections 4 and 5 intend to operate. Second, removing silent prayer could also have the unintended consequence of exempting other conduct that accompanied it, which could remove the operational discretion that's so vital in protecting both women and staff. Providing an exemption to continue the presence and behaviours that we know are intimidating undermines the bill entirely and betrays the testimony we've heard throughout this process. I invite any member who would like to understand this in more depth to contact me. For now, I will simply note that an exemption for silent prayer was proposed as an amendment to the Westminster Public Order Act, and it was rejected for very similar reasons. Likewise, there is no exemption in either the legislation now in force in Northern Ireland or that currently passing through in the Republic of Ireland. The bill in Northern Ireland, and with that lack of exemption, also passed the Supreme Court challenge, and proportionality had been looked at in that regard. Including an exemption would make Scotland an outlier among the UK nations and offer less protection to women and staff. I appreciate that the issue of reduction and extension has raised concerns. There has been some suggestion that maximum and minimum zone distances should be set and that further parliamentary scrutiny should be provided. Beyond the consultation amendment I've committed to today, I'm also committed to exploring what can be done to strengthen this area further at stage two. But I must also set out that the zones must be capable of providing needed protection for women and staff. I must also remain proportionate and not criminalise conduct where it cannot be justified. This, in my view, makes setting maximum and minimum distances unwise. None of us can know how services will be delivered in the future or how anti-abortion groups may change their behaviour. Any maximum or minimum could at this point therefore be arbitrary. In that case, the zones will not provide the protection needed. We could, for example, set 200 metres as the minimum distance, and in the future, 100 metres might be sufficient for some or all sites, or we may see behaviour that actually requires a larger distance. We therefore need the flexibility the bill currently provides to ensure we can respond to circumstances as they actually are in the future. That's also one reason I did not include a provision for additional oversight, even though I am, as you might imagine, an advocate for a strong and powerful Parliament. We heard in evidence that the ability to move swiftly to either extend or reduce zones for a variety of reasons is necessary, and I am, of course, happy to discuss this with members in more detail. Presiding Officer, I will draw my remarks to a close by thanking all members again for their contributions, not only today, but since I first proposed this bill. Their support and their constructive criticism have been invaluable. It would be remiss of me, Presiding Officer, to not, as Ross Greer did, thank Claire Bailey for blazing a trail on this issue and bringing it first to Northern Ireland. I want to again thank all of the campaigners, Abortion Rights Scotland, Back Off Scotland, BPass and many others who have been integral to this, as well as trade unions and representative organisations who have met me continuously through this process. It's also difficult to quantify what the support from officials, the current and former Public Health Ministers Jenny Minto and Marie Todd, means. They've helped guide me through this process, and the officials who have put their all into this bill and dealt with all the changes we've made with the utmost grace, no matter how short the timescale, and to the current and former First Minister. Nicola Sturgeon backed the bill and offered me the support of government. Hamza Youssef was the Cabinet Secretary for Health at the time and made support for this bill an integral part of his leadership campaign, has provided me with support consistently since then. Finally, my team and my parliamentary colleagues deserve a thank you for supporting me in the phenomenal way that they always do. As my opening speech highlighted, there are women who have sought abortion care and felt unable to defend themselves in the face of activity designed to shame and frighten them. Today, everybody in this chamber has a chance to show that they are willing to work on their behalf to provide them with a defence. and I would urge everyone in the Chamber to take that chance.
Thank you, Ms Mackay. That concludes the debate on Abortion Services Safe Access Zones Scotland Bill at Stage 1, and it is now time to move on to the next item of business.